Good morning. It's a little past 7 o'clock and we're gonna be feeding our starter, which is step one of making a loaf of sourdough bread. You can tell that it needs to be fed because it's low in the jar and we're not really seeing many bubbles. So that's telling me that the yeast is dormant. It's been in the fridge and bubbles are a sign of activity. So what I do is feed the starter with 50% flour and 50% water, and I do that by weight. So I use a scale. And what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go with 50 grams too. So I'll do 25 grams of wheat flour and then 25 grams of white. So we can scale.
Whoops.
That's okay. And then I'm gonna put in 50 grams of water. So now just stir it into the starter, get it all incorporated. And we're looking at the jar on the side. Right now it's here and we're gonna leave it further. An hour or so, come back and check it out and see how it's doing. So it's a little bit after 8, which means it's been about an hour. You can see that we've got pockets of CO2 bubbles on the side and that it's risen about an inch. So it's expanding because of the activity of the yeast. So what I'm gonna do is check to see if the starter is ready to be used in a loaf. And we do that by getting some water and we're gonna scoop some of the starter out and drop it in. If it floats to the top, then it's ready. If it sinks, then it's not quite there. So you can see it's sunk. So we're gonna give it another half hour and come back, see if it's ready then. Okay, so we tried yesterday to feed the starter and get things floating, but it wasn't really working out on the timeline that we needed. So I put it back in the fridge and now it's been out for the last hour and a half or so, just sitting on the counter. And dropping some in here and you're seeing now how it just sits on top of the water there. That's called the float test. That means the CO2 level inside is enough. There's enough pockets to cause it to float. It tells us that the activity of the yeast is nice and healthy and that this could raise a loaf of bread. So we're gonna go next to mixing all of our ingredients. Before we start making our bread, to talk just quickly about some things that are helpful to have gathered before you start. I like to use a kitchen scale. This is a digital one I picked up on Amazon, and I use a scale to measure all my ingredients. I don't use cups and volume in that respect. I like to use weight, a mixing bowl or two, a spoon, your flour, salt, this handy dandy tool here called a bench knife, and I'll show you how to use this later, but this has been very, very helpful. And of course, your sourdough starter. Okay, so we've got our scale set up. I've got a mixing bowl and a cat
who will not
stop crying. So what I'm gonna do is I use this ratio. I guess it's very popular with French baking. You do one part starter, two parts water, and three parts flour. So for the loaves I make, I try to shoot for 200 grams of starter. So that means I'm gonna do 400 grams of water. And now, 3 parts flour, so 600 grams of flour. This is what some might call overkill. I'm gonna sift my flour. So I have a second bowl and I have a sieve on top. I usually do, so 600 grams of flour, I'm gonna do 250 grams of whole wheat and then the rest white. So I'm starting with my whole wheat flour and I'm just pouring it on top of my sieve, but I'm watching the scale. So now I'm going to my white flour. Now that I've got it weighed out, I just bang the side of the sieve and it comes through. What this is doing is just breaking up the clumps of the flour and it makes it easier to work with. Okay, the last piece is the salt. So, since this is just a simple loaf of bread, wheat, water, starter, the only thing that's really providing flavor is salt. So, I like to weigh out around 10 to 12 grams of salt. There's 10. And I'm just gonna shake it over my ingredients. Now it's time to mix them all together and start the kneading process. So we've got all our ingredients in our mixing bowl. I'm just gonna take my spoon. And the first thing we're doing is incorporating all of the ingredients. Okay, now that it is a chunky clump, I'm gonna use my hands to incorporate it even more to really press it and get the soup loose. There we go. We got a ball. We're mixing the water in with the flour, which is the flour is dry. And now that we've got this ball, this is going to sit for a half an hour. And it's going to undergo a process, I guess that's called autolyse, where the gluten strands start to open up. They start to get activated because of the water. So this is just gonna sit for a half an hour. I'll see you then.
Okay.
Okay, so it's been a half an hour. The dough ball has been sitting under here. We're gonna lift this up. And you can see it's what we call a shaggy loaf. It's doesn't hold together. It's just very loose. That right there, that weird kind of texture, I guess you call that shaggy. So in order to take this to the next level, we need to knead it. So when we're kneading, we're basically just gonna be applying pressure, we're pushing it down, we're stretching it out. I'm gonna show you a few techniques that I like. And what that's doing is it's taking all the gluten strands that should be opened up now. While we knead them, they kind of get interlocked and they start forming a structure. So it's not gonna pull apart, but it's gonna be able to stretch. And as the yeast is kind of eating the sugars in the bread, creating CO2, that tight gluten structure is gonna help the bread rise. So we want to form that gluten structure now. That's what this step is all about. So I'm going to take off my ring because I always get so gummed up. All right, so this is the bench knife. The bench knife is amazing because it's going to be a kind of a sticky dough. So the bench knife is a good way of separating it from the counter. I like to start by just folding it on top of itself a few times, all right? And now this has to go aside and we just have to use our old fashioned hands. I'd love to tell you that you're not gonna get your hands all sticky and full of dough, but it's probably not the case. You're gonna probably get things stuck to you and it can feel really messy and even overwhelming at times, but that's part of this process. It's kind of like the chaos before the calm.
He's speaking directly to me because I always give up on bread at this point because I hate getting my hands dirty.
So you can see what I'm doing here is I'm just pressing the heel of my palm into the dough. I'm stretching it out, and then I kind of catch it with my fingertips and bring it back and just alternating hands. It's sticking to the counter, which is helpful because that gives me an opportunity to stretch it a bit. You want to do this, set a timer for realistically around 8 minutes. Okay. So I've been kneading this for about 5 minutes, and what I'm seeing here is that we've got a little more structure, it's got a little more stretch to it, and it's getting smoother. It's not there yet, but I'm gonna gather it up and show you kind of once it's at this place where it's feeling like a little smoother, a little more like there's some stretchability. I like to do this technique where I kind of grab the edge, give it like a little twist, and then flip it over itself. Grab the edge, and I'm just kind of pulling it back and flipping it on itself. And eventually, it's gonna kind of gather up. So I'm grabbing the edge, lifting, putting it down, flopping it over. Flopping it over. You can see on top, right now, as I'm flipping it, it forms an outer edge, but then that outer, this layer starts to tear. So our gluten's not quite strong enough yet. But I'm just gonna keep flipping this, just like this. So now it's kind of a ball, and I'm just grabbing the edge, picking it up, throwing it down, edge, picking it up, throwing it down. I'm gonna do this until the outside edge is looking smoother. It's not breaking up as much. And then that's gonna be a good indication that it's ready to rest. All right, so now we can see that this is looking really smooth. So at this point, our kneading process is done. What I'm gonna do is I'm going to form this into a tighter ball. I'm gonna cover it with the bowl and come back to it in an hour or so and see how it's looking. This is gonna be the first, we're entering the first stage of resting. We're gonna let it rest 3 times. So what I'm doing here is I'm taking my palms and putting them down against the counter. Then I gather the edge of the dough, and I'm just pulling it. As I'm pulling it on the counter, it's sticking on this side, and then it's tucking under itself. And I'm just gonna do that. So you get a nice tight ball. So I'm just lifting it up, shifting it 45 or 90 degrees, pulling, lifting, 90, pulling, lifting. And I'm just tightening up that outer edge. It's breaking up a bit, but that's okay. We're gonna let this rest. The gluten structure is gonna form even more. And when we come back, we should see this kind of spreading out a bit. And I'll see you in about an hour. Okay, so we've let our dough rest for a couple hours, and you can see that it is spread out. When I put it in here, it was a flat ball. It's kind of spread out. So the next few moves we're gonna be doing are gonna help give it shape. These are like structural moves for the dough. So I take my bench knife and loosen it all up and free it. right? And you can see it's kind of spreading out. And what I'm gonna do with wet hands, so they don't stick, I'm gonna reach under, I'm gonna lift and then fold this corner underneath the first third or the upper third. So you see it stretches, I fold it underneath and bring it down. I'm gonna do the same with this half, lift, fold it underneath. Now I'm gonna go this way. So I'm reaching under, lifting, folds underneath, lifting, folds underneath. So now we have kind of have this square and go right in the middle, lift, fold it together, okay? And then you remember that move from earlier where I kind of put my hand under and I'm gonna stretch it so it's catching on this side again. And that's just helping tuck the edges underneath. Do that a few times. And now we've got a new ball. It's nice and tight. And you can see it's nice and smooth. So this is gonna get covered. We'll leave it to rest for another couple hours, hour or two. And we're gonna do that same move again. So I'll see you pretty soon. All right, so it's been sitting for a couple of hours and it is a little spread out, but it's not as spread as far as it was the first time we let it rest. That's because the structure of the dough itself is becoming more established and it's just a stronger little loaf here. So this is gonna be our last shaping before it goes in the refrigerator. So what you're gonna wanna do is, I use a glass bowl, and I've had good success with that. And this cover fits right on there. Some kind of container. It's gonna go in the refrigerator from here until tomorrow
morning. Can you do plastic cover if you don't have a cover?
You can do a plastic wrap, yep. Some people do like a floured towel and then they put the dough inside a floured towel. I haven't had luck with that.
Fancy people have bread baskets.
Bread baskets would be ideal. but this is gonna be the same thing, the same process as last time. Use the bench knife to loosen it from the counter. And then just taking my hands, I'm gonna stretch it out a little bit, because it is a little more firm. So I'm just gonna stretch it and then going underneath, let that fold under, folding it in thirds again, underneath, folding it in thirds. If it butterflies out a bit, no big deal. I'm not looking for perfection.
Look at those bubbles. This is CO2, people.
Active yeast. Under, under. And now, one more underneath, and then we're just gonna do our stretch and pull. So that's just scooping it and pulling at the same time. Scoop, pull. Comes up into itself. Got a nice little dough ball. Just pick it up into the bowl.
And voila.
And that is gonna stay in the fridge until tomorrow morning. So I will see you in the morning. Okay, good morning. We're back. It's been a whole day since we started our sourdough loaf. Today, we're taking the loaf out of the fridge and we're gonna get it ready to be popped in the oven. So I like to bake in this Dutch oven. Ours is cast iron, there's ceramic. It doesn't really matter what material. If you got one, it's a great tool because you can heat this up real nice and it keeps the heat nice and consistent around the bread while it's baking. You don't have to use one of these. Before I got a Dutch oven, I used a baking sheet. And I just put my mixing bowl on top and I would put the bread underneath that. And of course you can just go straight onto a baking sheet. So we've got to preheat the oven. If you're using a baking sheet in a bowl, or a cast iron, or just a baking sheet, whatever you're gonna bake on, pop that in the oven. We're going to 475, and to let the cast iron really get hot, I usually let it come up to temperature, and then I set the timer for 15 minutes. That's just me. Okay, so this has been in the fridge since yesterday afternoon. Now,
ooh, look at that.
Yeah, it's a little risen. It's bubbly, it's airy. So this part can feel a little stressful the first time that you do it, and even I get a little stressed out sometimes because it's gonna feel like the dough is sticking to the bowl and it doesn't wanna come out. But you just gotta be gentle. So I've got my bench knife, I've got a spoon, a piece of parchment paper, and all I'm gonna do, tip this up and slowly work the dough away from the bowl. Okay, now I'm being gentle because you don't really wanna crush the dough. We've got all kinds of great rise going on in there. So I'm just gently kind of nudging it out onto the counter. Now it's upside down. I'm just gonna take my bench knife. I'm just gonna ease it over, okay? So now it's right side up. And I'm not gonna do a lot of shaping here. Just a little bit of tucking around the edges to kind of get it up into itself, just a little bit, a little tighter. But you don't wanna push it down. If you push it down, all your hard work is gone. And you don't really wanna give it too much activity here. It's just a little bit of tucking around the edge. Just so it's looking a little tighter, a little more, giving a little more shape. Then I'm taking this, goes on my parchment. The parchment, for me, it just gives me something to hold when I drop it in the oven. This is just sitting on the counter. And this is gonna come, it's gonna warm up a little bit from the refrigerator. But it's not, I'm not worried too much about getting it to a specific temperature. It's just gonna sit out for about a half an hour. We're in the home stretch, people. The dough has just been sitting. The oven's preheated with the Dutch oven inside. So this is an optional step. I'm going to wet my loaf. If you have a spray bottle, you can spray water. I did have a spray bottle, but my best friend put essential oils in it, so it can't be used for bread anymore. But a brush is just fine. And what this is doing by putting just a little layer of water on the top, on the outside, it's gonna slow the outside, the crust, from cooking so fast, which is gonna give it a little extra time to rise. And it also, inside the Dutch oven, is gonna create some steam, which I guess, according to the big guys, makes a difference. I've got a sharp knife here, and I'm gonna score the bread. Now, scoring is important because once the yeast feels the heat of the oven, it's gonna go crazy. It's gonna create CO2, and the bread's gonna wanna rise. If we don't score the outside edge, it's gonna rise, and it's just gonna stop. We kind of limit it. So by cutting the outside layers, it provides space for that expansion, and it's just gonna kind of blow open. So what you're looking for is about a quarter inch deep cut, and we're just gonna go, I just do an X from one side to the other. So I'm just applying some pressure, going right across, and you can see how deep that is. there. So that's one cut. And you don't have to be afraid of this process. You just kind of do it. You do it with some confidence.
That's satisfying.
And so I want you to notice this X here. You see how everything's close together, right? When we take this loaf out, these are gonna be like that wide because it's just gonna really open up, okay? So we're just gonna drop this in here. Again, the oven's at 475. You can hear that steam already going. Pop the cover on. Push to the back of the oven. And this is gonna bake at 475 for 25 minutes. So I'll see you then. All right, so when the timer goes off, our 25 minute timer, we're gonna just lower the temperature, the oven temperature, to 420. So we're at 475, we're going down to 420. We'll take the cover off the Dutch oven. If you're using a bowl on top of a baking sheet, you'll just take the bowl off. If you're not using anything, then you don't have to take anything off. But we're just gonna lower the temperature and leave our loaf in for another 20 minutes. All right, friends, it's the moment we've all been waiting for. The timer just went off. So, shutting down my oven, I'm gonna pull the bread out. Oh yeah. So you can see that we've got a nice golden crust.
Some sticky parchment paper.
Some sticky parchment paper, that's okay. I'll get it off after. And those are the X's that I cut in earlier. So you can see how they just totally blew open. And that gave the bread more potential to rise. And you can tap on the bottom. If it sounds nice and hollow, then you know it's got a good rise on it and it's cooked. If it sounds dense, like it's more thuddy, then it might need more time. But at this point, it should be pretty much cooked. So, everyone wants to just dive in when it comes right out. But in France, they say that it is against the law to sell bread that hasn't been cooled for 30 minutes. So, what's happening is that your bread is actually still cooking. So if you have the patience and you're able to wait that 30 minutes, then you're gonna get the inside, it's gonna cook all the way through. And if you wanna just jump in, I don't blame you, you can. It's gonna be fine. You're not gonna mess anything up. But I do as the French do. All right, friends. So I just cut my loaf open and I wanted to kind of show you what I'm looking at here. So you can see that we got some nice air holes, all these pockets here. That's a sign that we got a really good rise from our bread, and it's looking pretty consistent. And you can notice this kind of like oval pattern inside. That is a result of those structural folds that we did earlier yesterday, kind of our shaping folds. So those are the kind of things we're looking for. Obviously, the key to success, or the key of success anyways, is a delicious edible loaf. So if it tastes good, then that's a win. But if you have those nice patterns inside, kind of the indications that you've got a really good loaf going on, and it's something to just keep working towards. So that's it, folks. That's our sourdough process. And I hope that was helpful. Hope it was a little insightful. If you have any questions, just let us know. So your sourdough culture is a living little community of yeast. Because it's alive, that means it needs to be fed and nourished. You are its caretaker. Luckily, feeding and caring for your sourdough is super easy. All it needs is flour and water. And the ratio is so simple to remember, 50-50. So whatever you put in for flour, you just match that by weight in water. So right now, we've got our dough ball auto-leasing. So I am gonna feed my starter. I'm gonna put this back in the fridge for the next time that I make a loaf. I used 200 grams of starter. So I'm gonna put in 100 grams. Actually, since I have some left, I'm gonna do 75 grams of flour. And I do 50-50. White and whole wheat. So here's 75 grams of flour and pour in 75 grams of water. Now we stir it up. I went a little over, so I'll just balance it with some more flour. So whenever you're feeding your starter, whether it's to put it back in the fridge after you've just used some to make a loaf, or you want to feed it a bit to wake it up before baking, it's always 50-50. Whatever you put in for flour, just match it with 50%, an equal amount of water.
How long will it stay lively in the fridge?
In the fridge? I find that I can go 5 to 7 days in between baking sessions. The longer you go, the more you have to feed it before you use it. Just because.
So like feed it every day for a couple of days if it's kind of dead?
If it's feeling dead, like it's really flat, and smells super sour and stinky, then it might have gone too long. In that case, you just want to take out, like if you have that much starter in there and it's just flat and really nasty, you just take out most of it, so leave a little bit in the bottom, and then throw in a whole bunch of flour and water.
Still 1-to-1 though.
1-to-1, yep. And you're just getting that, giving it like a whole bunch of food so that the yeast colony can ramp back up.
And then if you have to keep doing it, you can keep like halving it and feeding it again, right?
Yeah, if you want to go for a while in between bakes especially, you should feed it probably every 5 to 7 days. Just scoop a little out, add some new flour and water, stir it in, pop it back in the fridge.
Cool. Mm-hmm.